Welcome to First United Lutheran Church. This is the message from Sunday. It's our prayer that this message touches your heart and helps to guide you in your life. Let's listen.
It is wonderful to see a full house today. It is just absolutely wonderful. So welcome to worship and to our Sunday School Christmas program this morning. Few announcements. Remember the Christmas Eve candlelight service here at the church, 5:30. The youth mission trip fundraiser meal is today. Do you smell it? If you don't smell it yet, you will be shortly, won't you? Now that I've got it in your brain, you're going to be smelling meatballs, mashed potatoes, comfort food. That fundraiser is this morning following worship in the Sunday School program. It's a free will offering. And while Women of the Word are still accepting donations for the Adopt-A-Family, there is a bucket in the narthex. I know that families have been assigned. It's anonymous. They don't know who they're getting for. They don't know. So it makes it very confidential. But they have a list. And they are buying gifts, and I know they would appreciate anything that you might be willing to give for those families who are struggling a little bit this Christmas season. On Wednesday the 22nd at 6:30 here at the church at no charge, they will be showing the movie Christmas with the Chosen, The Messengers. Coffee and cookies will follow. Debbie tells me the cookies have been ordered, so there are treats. And please come, invite a friend or two or maybe three to come enjoy that movie. The youth are selling Christmas ornaments. Christmas ornaments. You see them in the back. They're $10 each. And that's a fundraiser, of course, for their mission trip. I do have potatoes, 5 pounds for $5, but I see the sign is missing. But you know what? Find Paula. Find Beth. They're downstairs. Okay, we have a sign like this. It's not a bad sign. Potatoes are for sale downstairs, so if you're interested, fresh potatoes, $5 for 5 pounds. We have a birthday in the house today. Mm-hmm. We have someone who is turning 18 years old. Wow. Hannah, are you hiding? I see another finger pointing over there. She's hiding. She's in the back. If you come for the meal, you'll see her, and you will know it's her. Happy birthday, Hannah. God's blessings to you. And, okay, now, Bella. We talked about this. You see these bright, shining faces. There's four teams. You notice one of the teams are adults, Paula, Jenna, and DJ. And then the others are our youth group kids. Most of these kids are going on the mission trip this summer. The others who are pictured were wonderful helpers, and these four teams put together gingerbread houses. And now, Bella, you get to see gingerbread house number one. Beautiful, isn't it? Gingerbread house number two. Unfortunately, in transport, this house suffered just a little bit. And so to make the best of a bad situation without being nasty, mean, or otherwise, it reminds us to pray for our tornado and storm victims. They had a terrible disaster last week. And this is really a good thing. It reminds us. Number three. This one's beautiful. I like the gumdrops. And number four. And I love those on top. They look really good. So you saw those four houses. Downstairs, in front of these four houses, are buckets like this, like our noisy offering bucket. Each one has a picture, the ones you just saw, with a number 1, 2, 3, or 4. You are invited to vote for your favorite gingerbread house with cash. Because this is a fundraiser for our mission trip youth. Now, Paula has told me that the house or the bucket with the most money wins. What do they win, Paula? I didn't ask you that. Oh, bragging rights. Bragging rights are always good, aren't they? They're wonderful. All the monies collected, of course, will go for the mission trip. That's not in question. They don't win the money. But whether you want to vote with pennies, dimes, nickels, quarters, or dollar bills, or $5 bills, vote. Paula has them set up on a table just as you come into the fellowship hall, so stay for the meal. Vote for your very favorite gingerbread house. By the way, you don't know who made what, do you? It's just those four teams. But you can probably guess on some of them. So vote for your favorite house. And the youth are selling ornaments, and they're also selling potatoes. So I would say this is a youth Sunday, wouldn't you? Definitely. Now, also check the bulletin, check the website. The website has a church calendar link. It's updated almost daily as things change. Sometimes it's updated more than once a day, things like that. Any announcements that I failed to get into the bulletin or that I should mention today? No? Any prayer concerns? If not, shall we bow our heads in prayer? Lord Jesus, Master of both the light and the darkness, send your Holy Spirit upon our preparations for Christmas. We who have so much to do and seek quiet spaces to hear your voice each day. We who are anxious over many things look forward to your coming among us. We who are blessed in so many ways long for the complete joy of your kingdom. We whose hearts are heavy seek the joy of your presence. We are your people, walking in darkness, yet seeking the light. To you we say, come, Lord Jesus. We pray for those named in our hearts and on our prayer list today. Ray, Joanne, Renee, Sean, Tyler, Vicky, Sophie, Carol, Ada, the tornado and storm victims. They have so much to endure in the weeks, months, and years to come. We pray for our missionaries, the people who are working on our behalf, Mark and Danielle, Gary and Minnie. We ask, Lord, that you grant them peace, comfort, healing, guidance, those things that you, Lord, that you know they need. Father, as we meet today, may we behold your beauty and encounter your grace. We ask all of this in the wonderful name of Jesus. Amen. And we have the lighting of the Advent candles. At last, it says, at last, the fourth Sunday in Advent. The first candle, a purple candle, is light, gave us light to wait, and it was a long wait. The second candle, another purple candle, gave us light to prepare, and we are almost ready. The third candle, a pink candle, helped us to celebrate God's promise to come. And now as we light the fourth candle, yet another purple one, we light that to remind us that Jesus, the light of the world, is coming to us. From Isaiah 9, the people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in a land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. In our Advent prayer today, God of love, you have sent us your Son as the light of the world. Even now that light is breaking in upon us. May we reflect the light of your love, even as we wait for you to come again. Amen. Thank you, Jackson. Our psalm today is Psalm 43. Verses 3 through 5. Send me your light and your faithful care. Let them lead me. Let them bring me to your holy mountain and to the place where you dwell. Then I will go to the altar of God, to God, my joy and my delight. I will praise you with the lyre, O God, my God. Why, my soul, are you downcast? Why so disturbed within me? Put your hope in God, for I will praise him, my Savior and my God. We are honored today with special music and The young ladies who are singing that are now invited to come forward. They are singing, as I understand, O Holy Night.
Everybody is invited to sing this.
I'm just stepping in the back.
That was beautiful. And now it's time for the Sunday School Christmas program. I invite all the kids to come up and find your spot on the stage.
Tonight I look up at the stars in the sky and remember another star from days long gone by that shone oh so brightly to show us the way to a small baby laid in the manger of hay.
This baby was sweet and shiny and new, but it means so much more to me and to you. We know him as Jesus Christ, or Emmanuel. And the story is one we have long left to tell.
Because it is a story of the best of man, of mercy and sacrifice and God's all-knowing plan. It is a story of love beyond measure, of a father who gave his most prized, precious treasure.
I think of all this as I look at the stars. I think about the love of God, of this God of ours, and I close my eyes, fold my hands, and I pray that I will remember this love every day.
The cows would admit they were slightly confused at the way that their manger was about to be used. The sheep could acknowledge they did not understand at the presence of this woman, this child, and this man. The donkeys and horses were all a bit lost. They believed in being welcoming, but what was this cost?
Strangers in the stable, taking up space, and now bringing in more people all over the place. People who came with some strange smelling herbs and whose voices they were sure left the baby disturbed. But the baby slept on, untroubled by fame, by all of the people putting reverence to his name. So the cows and the sheep, they decided they liked.
This relaxed and imperturbable young little tyke, and they vowed to protect him whatever the price. From soldiers and swindlers and maybe even headlice, they could not know what he would have to endure to bring light unto humankind forevermore. But that night in that stable, they surrounded him gently with the love of the animals, felt simply and intently.
Silent night, holy night.
In the month of December, a long time ago, in a land full of sand, we now think of snow.
They shone in the sky, a bright guiding star, whose light one day he would reach land near and far.
Beneath that bright star, a smiling, living boy with more than most babies, a source of great joy. Magicians, Buffalo Man, Lanana, and Uncle Miss Molly would one day stand tall. He would be a great teacher, a leader of men, but also a carpenter, a man, a friend.
For little one, hold your hands in. Hey, don't you take me out. Send it away.
This stable is old. The wood is worn smooth. The night air is cold and filled with soft coos.
From a boy in the manger asleep in the hay to this place a stranger with nowhere else to lay.
But this building remembers a thousand of births, a meadow, a million Decembers, not talking of winter.
Each calf that was birthed, each foal and each lamb was considered just as dear when their birth was at hand.
This boy is important, but the barn does not know that he is any different from other babies in the snow.
But still it accepts him as one of its own and gladly protects him from the wind and the cold.
In this wholehearted welcome, Christmas began when, in the midst of a whale storm, someone held out a hand.
The Christmas Story. Once upon a time, a long, long time ago, begins the story of a baby that most of you should know. His daddy's name was Joseph, and Mary was his mom. This baby was very special. He was God's only son. Some angels came from heaven, and they began to sing.
To the shepherds in the fields below, glad tidings we do bring. A bright star lit the heavens to light the Magi's way to the baby in the manger who was born on Christmas Day. And all who gathered round him rejoiced and praised his birth, for the babe, the King, our Savior, is our Savior here on earth.
Every heart prepared in bloom, and heard in nature's strain.
turn? Okay, boys and girls, I'm good. Boys and girls, I need you to turn around, slide back just a wee bit, and have a seat. So you brought us a story. Now I'm going to bring you a story. How does that sound? Does that sound okay? I got to do a little setup. Normally I wait for you guys to come up and find a place and do everything, but you were already here. You made things different today. It's okay when things are different, isn't it? Now, we're going to have a story. Who do you think the story is going to be about? The cat. Those of you who have heard the story before and those of you out there, there's a little black kitty named Boris. You see the little black kitty, don't you? Yeah. Boris was in a shelter, and Boris was so alone and so scared. And guess what? There was another kitty who told him all about Jesus, all about God. And Boris has invited God into his life. Okay? So this is about Boris, if you haven't heard about him before. Uh-oh, we're not quite ready yet. Here's Boris. Presents. We always have to have presents, don't we? Presents. Oh, uh-oh. Forgot the most important things for myself, didn't I? Okay. We might be set. So this one is called The Best Christmas Present. Presents are good, aren't they?
Yeah.
They're wonderful. Okay. So it was Christmas Eve. That's coming up close, isn't it?
Yeah.
In the middle of the living room, we'll pretend this is the middle of the living room, there was a tree. The story says a giant tree. Couldn't do that, sorry. There's a tree that's all decorated, and underneath the tree there are beautiful presents. Boris, the kitty of the house, remember Boris?
Yeah.
He sniffs the tree, and he looks at these presents, and he goes, He's just so excited, he's ready to open presents now. And remember, Boris has a human, mom and dad, that's what he calls them, his mom and dad. And they go, Boris, you have to wait till Christmas morning. And they go, but he's so very excited. It's going to be a long night for him. And so the humans in the house decide to go upstairs and go to bed. Boris is not ready to go to bed yet. From his spot under the Christmas tree, he watched his parents climb the stairs. He was way too excited. Are you excited on Christmas Eve?
Yeah.
Yes, you are. So you know how Boris feels. He looked at the tree when it first arrived. He climbed all the way to the top of the tree. How many of you have had a cat climb your... Yeah, there you go. Cat climbed my mom and dad's tree many years ago. Knocked it over, broke it, broke all the ornaments. That was when there were ornaments on it. Boris climbed it when there weren't any. He looked at the tree and he thought he'd climb it again, but he decided that might not be a good idea. So he was pawing at these presents and he was wondering which one was his. And all of a sudden Boris goes, oh, guess what? I didn't get a present for my mom and dad. What am I going to do now? There's a present. Boris is all concerned. He didn't get a present. Boris then decided to sit next to the nativity scene. I'm going really old school with this. How many of you remember flannel graph from way back when we were little? Right? So he sits next to the nativity scene and he goes, I want to give them a gift, but I don't know what I should give them. What should I give them? He thought really hard and he looks down and he sees Mary and Joseph. And there are animals. We've got camels in the distance. Ah, Paula, are you here? They even have pigs in the manger scene. There are, we have chickens. In the distance, we have shepherds. Up close, we have more shepherds. Couldn't find the right sizes. We even have some geese. We've got a lot of animals. Oh, and you guys, you talked about the wise men, the magi. They were here at the manger scene as well. Okay? So now Boris is looking at this scene from underneath the tree, and he is still wondering what he can do for a present for his mom and dad. Boris looks and he goes, I don't see a cat. Nope, there's no cat in sight. And as he's looking, a beautiful angel appears. Don't be afraid, says the angel. My name is Noel, and I've come to help you. Boris said, but I don't have a Christmas present for my parents. What should I do? Can you help me? And the angel says, yes, I believe I can help you. But first, I want to tell you a story about another cat with the very same problem. His name was Gideon. Now we have Gideon in the story. Uh-oh, I lost it. Thank you very much. We need that one. That one's an important one. Gideon lived a long, long time ago in a city called Bethlehem. You talked about Bethlehem today. He lived with the other animals in the stable in the inn. One night, a young couple were forced to spend the night in that stable. And you told that story today in your songs and in your readings. During the night, a very special baby was born. Do we remember who that baby is?
Jesus,
exactly. He's the Son of God. The kings and the shepherds, they all brought gifts for the baby. All the animals gave gifts too. The animals started to boast about the gifts they gave. The donkey goes, I gave him a ride. And the sheep said, well, we provided wool for his blanket. They're getting a little boasting, aren't they? Cow says, well, I gave him milk. And the ducks, remember I said it was important? I gave feathers for a pillow. The animals turned to Gideon and they said, what did you bring the baby? And he said, I don't have anything to bring to this baby, said the cow. Cats are useless. All they do is sleep and eat. Is that true? Is that all they do?
No.
Gideon sat down next to Mary, which means now we have to have a kind of a small Gideon. Gideon goes next to Mary. And he says, I want to give Jesus a gift, but I have nothing to give. You've already given a wonderful present, said Mary. What? Asked Gideon. Mary said, you gave Jesus your love, and that's the most important gift of all. But Gideon still doesn't quite understand. He goes, what should I do? Mary says, I know how you can give it. She picked Gideon up and snuggled him next to the baby Jesus because Jesus was wrestling and restless and just not comfortable. He wasn't sleeping. And you've all known babies who just can't sleep, don't you? They cry, they make noise, and you can't get anything done. And then what do? So Mary had Gideon snuggle in the manger right next to Jesus. And the purring and the warm fur settled Jesus down and he went to sleep. Wow! Boris is watching this story and he says, I know exactly what I'm going to do. Noel, who has told the story, says, goodbye, Boris. Merry Christmas. And she disappeared. Boris looks at the nativity scene and he sees that Gideon is snuggled next to Jesus. Merry Christmas, Gideon, Boris said. And then he runs upstairs, jumps into bed with his parents. He snuggles right between them and gives them the very best Christmas of all. Christmas present of all, too. What was it?
Love.
Love. That's the very best present, isn't it? And that makes a very merry Christmas. So that's Boris's story. And Boris has a little gift for you guys. It is not a heart, but it is red and it is white. Who would like to help? Dean, do you want to come help me do this? You get candy canes today.
Yay.
No choice. Handful.
There you go.
Perfect. You start on this side, I start on this side. Merry Christmas. And once you get your candy cane, you can go find Mom and Dad again. You're welcome. Here you go.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Here you go. Here you go. There you are. Everybody good? Good. And at this time, we will receive the offering if the ushers would like to come forward. Ushers.
Thank you for your giving this morning. Remain standing for the reading of the gospel. Two short sections of the book of John this morning, found in chapter 1, verses 1 through 5, and then 19 through 21. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through Him, all things were made. Without Him, nothing was made that has been made. In Him was life, and that light was the life of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. And then moving to verse 19. Now this was John's testimony when the Jewish leaders in Jerusalem sent priests and Levites to ask him who he was. John did not fail to confess, but he confessed freely, "I am not the Messiah." And they asked him, "Then who are you? Are you Elijah?" And he said, "I am not." "Are you the prophet?" He answered, "No." The light of the world. As you're seated, give Christmas greetings to somebody that's here this morning and tell them you're glad they made it.
Aren't they great? These kids are they're just the greatest. It just brings out, I think, to all of us the innocence of that which we once were. And, I think one of the greatest things about this time of the year is that we get a chance to stop and to think back and to look back into a tiny window of time. That little moment of time in Bethlehem when for just a little while, everything was right. Everything was as it should be. And that's what I hope to convey this morning, is that we just put the brakes on just for a minute, and we stop and consider that little window of time. So before I begin, let's just open our hearts in prayer. Heavenly Father, I thank you for the light, that you are the light of the world, and that you took the effort, the time, and had the love and the concern that you came and revealed yourself to us in the darkness as we are, in the darkness that we have created, in the darkness that we insist upon cloaking ourselves with. Yet in that darkness you came with the light, and the light has shined in that darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. Bless our time together these few minutes. In Jesus' name, amen. Three really quick thoughts. Today, we lit the candle of light, so I'm going to talk about light. There are probably some physicists or some physics students that are with us this morning that have deeply, deeply studied light and the mystery that it is. It is an amazing invention of God. For the physicists, of course, is it a particle? Is it a wave? You know, we could talk about that. The only aspect of light that I want to talk about this morning is that it is invisible. We say, what do you mean invisible? There's light all around us. Well, yeah, it is. But the only reason we comprehend that there is any light anywhere in this room is because it's reflecting off of something. If you look at the sun or pictures of the sun, you got that big ball of brilliant light. But all around it is what? Darkness. It's empty. There's nothing there. If I had a flashlight, which I meant to do and I forgot it, and I turned it on over here and I held my hand up here, what would you see? You'd see the brilliance of the incandescence of the light, and you would see the reflection off my hand. But in between, well, if we had a dirty church, you'd see flecks of dust. But the light itself is invisible. So what do I make such a thing about that? Well, the point that I'm making out of this is the only hope that the light that is Christ, that is the light of the world, has of being seen by anyone, is its reflection. Now, you've been in a dusty room in an afternoon when the sun is streaming through the window, and you see that beam of light coming down. Well, what do you see? You're seeing the light. You're seeing the reflection off those little particles of dust. Or if you go into the night sky, you look at the moon. The moon is a great big piece of dust, but it has no power to give its light, its own light. It's just reflecting that which comes off the sun. So we've got these tiny little flecks of ice or dust. We've got these huge collection of dust like the moon. You and I are like medium size particles of dust. But we are quite unique particles of dust in that we have got the power to drag something between us and the light. Or think of a lighthouse where you've got this brilliant
you know, multi-million candle power light that's shining in there, but it really doesn't get out to see until it hits the reflector that's behind it, you know. You and I are like that reflector. But we're unique reflectors in that we have got the power to decide whether we want to be tarnished and give off just a little bit of dullness, or do we allow the lighthouse keeper to scrub us and polish us and get us to a point where we can shine that beam through the darkness and keep a ship from crashing in the breakers. That's the first thing, reflected light. Second point, resident light. Think about that. We are born with a love for light. We like to be in the light. Of course, when we're sleeping, we like to be where it's a little less light, but the point is we are born to love the light. Now, Sadhu Sundar Singh was a brother from East India. And he noticed one day at a construction site, the guys rolled away a huge rock and there was all kinds of things under there that came boiling out. And the minute they got into the sunlight, they scurried off to find some other shadow to find their way in, to hide. You and I are a little bit of a dichotomy. We're born with the love for light. But we're also like those creatures of the shadow, that we do things, we have done things, perhaps we have something planned that is a deed of the darkness. We're both. We are both. We have the power to select which one of those things we are going to be. One of the greatest, best written stories of all time, I think, of secular stories that was ever written was Edgar Allan Poe, when he talked about the cask of Amontillado. Many of you, when you were little, have read that story. This is a story about a guy that another fella had a big grudge against, and he lured him deep, 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 deep into a cave. And while he wasn't thinking, he clapped him in irons and then slowly, slowly began to build a brick wall where he would perish. And one of the last lines in that story were, "For the love of God, bring back the light." And then the last brick was placed in the hole. And it's like this chill went through me as I read that story, that I think I like the light too. I think I like the light too. Resident light. That's the light that we were born with. So we are reflections, reflectors of God, or God's light. And within us, we also have a light. The third point is released light. How do we let the power of light work through our lives? Well, if you've ever been in a garage or something where somebody is working on a car, and in the olden days they just had just a little flashlight they'd give you, and your job as a kid was to hold the light. So there's Dad deep into the engine, and as a kid we get distracted and we're off shining this light around looking for a bird that's flying around in the Quonset or something. Dad, bam, hits his head. Bring back that light and do your job. You've been there. You've been one or the other. Probably both at some time or another. Do your job. Hold the light. There's another story about a little kid in old Russia. He was over visiting his grandfather deep in the forest. His grandfather fell ill during the day, and by the time he realized that he's going to need some help, it was pitch black. And he lived deep in a swamp, and he said to the young boy, "You've got to go home and bring some help, or I will die." The little boy, all he had was this tiny, tiny, tiny little lantern. And the boy held it up, and he said, "But grandfather, I can't see my destination with this light." And the grandfather said, very wisely, "With each step you take, the light will illumine the next steps where you are to go." And isn't that a lot like us? We don't know what's coming tomorrow. We have no clue between where we are and our final destination, which is, unless Christ comes back, our destination is the grave. We don't know what's between here and there. The only thing that we have got is this: "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." The only thing that we've got is this. And it doesn't show us every single thing that's going to happen to us on our pathway through life. But God says, like the old man said to the boy, if you take this light with you, take the lamp, keep it close to you, and it will show you where your next step is going to be. It will show you step by step where is the safe ground and where is the sinkhole. Three things. We are called to be reflectors of the light. We have it within us to place something between us and the light. Oh, yes, we do. We have got the power to definitely mess up our lives. We have definitely got the ability to hash things up and not shine any kind of light whatsoever. But we also have it in our power to expose ourselves to the light and to become a reflector, reflection of it. As the saying goes, God, I want to be a full moon. Big, bright reflection, not the tiny sliver. Close with one last story. This story comes out of China during the Great March of Mao Zedong. It's estimated that he murdered nearly 40 million peasants who resisted his viewpoints. It was a literal tidal wave of blood. As the army approached a certain village, the people were escaping at night as best they could through a dark forest. There was an old man that was leading a small group of three or four with his tiny, tiny lantern. But in the village there sat a young man. He was holding a flagon of wine, and he was sitting beside a very, very large lantern that was turned down so low it was nearly out. And the young man was making fun of the old guy leading his three or four out of the village. "How pathetic," he said to the young man, or to the old man. "You will come to the end of your life, old man, and on your deathbed you will weep to think that you have helped so few." "Perhaps," said the old man, "but in the morning when the wicked men come to destroy you, you will be equally dead. But with your life will end with a great and terrible burden, knowing that you had the ability to save many, but save none. Not even yourself." So my question this morning is, what's the condition of my lamp? Is it lit? Second, what's the condition of my spirit? Am I striving to reflect Christ, the light of the life? Are you a missionary or are you a mission field? One or the other. Think of the candlelight service that we're going to have in just a couple of days. What would happen if the person at the front of the row, once their candle was lit, refused to pass it on to the next person? The church would remain fairly dark. It is the light of many small flames that make the church light up. Of course, we are but flecks of dust in a very large room of great darkness. The question is this: Are we allowing ourselves to be placed where the light can reflect from us? Are we hiding in the shadow of something that we pulled between us and the light? Of course, we are only the reflectors behind the light in the lighthouse. Question is this, is our condition polished or is it unpolished? Have we allowed the lighthouse keeper to make the light shine because of our brilliance? Let's close with prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you for bringing the light to us. I thank you that the light has not changed in these thousands of years, nor, for that point, has the condition of the world. There are still emperors and kings who would seek to extinguish the light, to send their soldiers through the street to try to find that light and put it out. Thank you that you have given to us the gift of being reflectors. I pray this morning that we would respond to that call to help reflect the light of you in this world around us. In Jesus' name we pray, for his sake, amen. Now, this morning we're going to share communion. As you came in, I think there were a few communion kits, I'll call them. Some of you may prefer to use those individual kits, and so I will go through the order of service with these, but then we'll also open the table up to join communion at the front. But before we begin, let's pause for a moment of reflection. Heavenly Father, each of us, all of us, are here this morning with the stain of sin upon us. We have sinned against you in the things that we think. We have sinned against you in the things that we have said. And we have sinned against you by the things that we have done. This morning, Lord, in humility, we ask you for your forgiveness. Through the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, we come before you, ask that you would forgive us for those many sins and help us to renew, to be renewed in you, to become reflectors of the light. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So the words of institution we find in Corinthians, 1 Corinthians 11, chapter 11, verses 23 through 26, where Paul says this, "For I received from the Lord that which I delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the same night in which he was betrayed, he took bread. When he took the bread, he broke it, and he gave thanks. And he said, take and eat, for this is my body, which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let us share together the body of Christ. And in the same manner also, he took the cup after supper, and he said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. And this do as often as you drink it, in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and you drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." Let us share together the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now I would invite the servers to come forward. Let's pray together our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Now I'd like to invite you to stand as you're able, and and join us in singing our closing hymn, What Child Is This? Receive the benediction. May the Lord bless you and keep you. May the Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. May the Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you his peace. In the name of the Father and the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thank you for listening to this message from First United Lutheran Church.